take the leap, change your career, change your life. I am very excited to be speaking with Sara Bliss this morning. She is a New York Times bestselling author, consultant, speaker, brand advisor, and I saw a segment on the Today Show, and I sent a message, and I was like, I must read this book, and I must chat with Sara about this. So many people will connect to it. It's just fabulous. Welcome to Reading with Robin.
Thank you. I'm so thrilled to be on here.
I'm so happy to meet you finally. I'm like, how have our paths not crossed up until this point? It's amazing to me because I'm so connected to your writing and what you write about and what you talk about in your books. And go to sarabliss.com for more information. When did the book came out? In December?
It did. It did.
And so you're still touring. You're still doing events.
I am. I feel like I am knee-deep in it. I am going to Boston this week, and then the first week of March, I'm planning time in San Francisco and L.A., and I'm
fabulous.
Doing something in Salt Lake City. So
there's
a
around.
Lot of good stuff happening.
Well, this is a book. I mean, to me, this is a book for everybody. There's nobody that would read this book and not take something away from it. That's impossible. But also, I don't know about you, but I have a lot of friends who like to talk about making change, continually talk about making
yes,
change.
Yes.
And I was with one recently. I'm like, take a look at this. Look at this awesome book I'm reading. And I think it's such a great gift to give somebody, right?
I wrote this book for those people. I mean, those people that really want to make a change. So many people are unhappy with their jobs. So many people want to be doing something else, but they don't do it. They're afraid, or they're nervous about the financials, or they think they're too old, or too experienced at something else, too invested in something else. So I wrote this book for them so they would see examples of people just like them in their same circumstances with their same problems, overcoming them to find the career of their dreams.
And it's so important. I mean, it's not a, dress rehearsal, which we know. And there, this idea of years ago sticking with something forever and then retiring, that does not exist anymore for the most part. If you love what you do and people do things, and I'm always fascinated by people who reinvent themselves all along the way, or take up something
yes.
new in their 80s or 90s, like, why not? And just staying in something, I mean, there are certainly reasons and that people do sometimes, but you have so many examples of people who have really, it seems like a lot of lawyers. I don't know why anyone's going to
yes,
law school
to
anymore.
Yes, I actually had to stop
with the lawyers.
Taking submissions from people who were lawyers in their past lives because there were just too many of them, and I wanted a really wide variety.
So you had a plethora of that, right? I mean, was that the biggest pool from which you had to go, enough lawyers?
Exactly. It's lawyers and then finance. I looked for the most interesting types of changes, but I also looked at, what careers they were coming from. And another problem with kind of law and finance is that I think the perception from the outside with those careers is, okay, those people have enough money saved up that they can do this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So I did want to find a lot of people who maybe weren't in those circumstances, who wanted to start businesses but, didn't have any money of their own to invest, or people who were, moms with a lot of kids or whatever the issue was, whether it's financial or their life circumstances. I really wanted a huge variety.
Well, well done. There's something for everybody here. And I have dog-eared all of my many of my favorites. They're all favorites. It's a fascinating, they're just long enough, the stories you get. I mean, I had so many ideas even just reading this book, and I'm on the phone with Sara Bliss. Her book is Take the Leap, Change Your Career, Change Your Life. So I had seen the story on the Today Show, Marjorie Gubelman, and it just captured my attention. I was doing something else. I was like, wait, who is this? And so that was the story. I don't know if others from this book have been highlighted on the show. Talk a little bit about Marjorie's story.
Marjorie's story is one of my favorites in the book, and I always say if you're not following her on Instagram,
I am now.
Find her right now because she's having more fun than anyone. She's she's 49, and she's an international DJ. But she started actually at 42, she was the CEO of a candle company and a single mom, recently divorced.
Mm-hmm.
And she ended up going to DJ school with teenagers.
Oh, cool.
And she did it secretly, which I love. She told one friend, mm-hmm. and she thought, you know, maybe it's just a phase. And she just loved it. She felt lit up and excited about life and like a teenager again. She had had a radio show when she was in college,
mm-hmm.
so kind of brought her back to her youth. And now she DJs around the world for brands like Dolce & Gabbana, and they pay and fly her out and tell
them. She is having a great time.
Amazing.
I started following her after that segment because I just loved her energy.
Yes.
Like you say, just lit up. And I like that she also talked about that she's playing, you know, danceable music that people would know, you know.
Yes.
Not
out there
trying to reinvent anything. I liked everything about her. And so that's how I found your book. So thank you, Today's Show and Marjorie. And then I think, as I told you, it turns out we had your book because my daughter was sent your book by your editor. So, I mean, there's so many books here.
That's amazing.
So I'm like, wait, Emily said, wait, it's right here.
Well, that's funny. You know, Kara Bedick, who was my editor on this, I just adored working with her. And this is actually my 11th book because I have written books on my own, but I also was a co-author and ghostwriter for 7 books.
Wow.
So I always say, you know, this is Kara's the editor that I've worked with many amazing editors, but Kara is the editor I've kind of always dreamed of working with. She's so collaborative, and we were really partners in this book and finding the people in it, and she had so many great ideas for how to really, really reach the audience and make it quick and easy to read. And
well, it's fabulous.
Lots of takeaways.
So you have a lot of my favorites in here. Jill Cardman, who I've been following for a long time, and I love her story. And
I do,
it must
too.
Have been an awful lot of fun interviewing Jill, I would think.
Jill is so much fun to interview. She is just like a walking soundbite. She does things that you're just crying, laughing when you're trying to be professional and do the interview. But she is another great mom story. I mean, she was a novelist, a really successful novelist, and had 3 kids. And she had acted in college and had loved it, but just thought it wasn't a career for her. She didn't have the right look for it, and
mm-hmm.
she was. Didn't want to kind of have the, you know, starving artist part of it. And she ended up starring in her own show and producing her own show and acting for the first time as the star on Bravo for her
show
Odd Mom Out, which is no longer airing new episodes, but is definitely worth, if you haven't seen
you're in. These are the kinds of shows that if you've never seen them, I'm always like jealous of people that get to rewatch them, because Odd Mom Out was fabulous. All of Jill's books and
clever and smart.
I love that she said pregnancy meant she wasn't edgy, and she was 28 or whatever in that story.
You know, that's the thing too. Is I really when I did these interviews, obviously I wanted to talk about, you know, how people made these career switches, and I especially looked for kind of dream jobs that people switch to.
Mm-hmm.
But I also really wanted to know, you know, what was tough about this? What were the struggles that you had to deal with? Like, what were the internal struggles? What were people's opinions on the outside? Like, how did you deal with all that? And so, you know, I looked for people also who were really candid and honest about what that really looked like. And she was as well. So that was really important to me. And I think that that's missing in a lot of business writing is kind of the emotional journey that people take.
You could teach a class, Sara, and I am on the phone with Sara Bliss, and her brand new book is Take the Leap, Change Your Career, Change Your Life. Find her at sarabliss.com. You can find her on Twitter. I know I did. And Instagram, I guess, Facebook.
Yep, I'm on both of those as Sara Bliss NYC.
She's everywhere. And I think your point about Marjorie in secret going to DJ class, I mean, there are like those dream stealers, you know, in our lives. And so I guess when you put it out there, there's a sense of now I own it, so people are watching. So there's that. Then there are people that are like, don't lose your your insurance benefits. Don't leave
that
job.
Yeah, don't quit your day job.
Right, so there's that. Right, exactly, or another way to put it. And then there's, you know, the people that are supportive, but I think if a person is looking to make a change, certainly there are always objections. There's always, like, the reason not to do it, but there's that reason to do it, that spark that maybe this can work. And I do think that's an interesting missing part, but that's why you're listening to people's stories. And if you can't go and hear everybody's story in person, you can get this awesome book, Take the Leap, and be inspired. And I'm sure reach out to some of these people. You know, people are pretty accessible, or they've written on their websites, and you can, you know, get even more information. Or, you know, they're not all going to sit down with you and do an interview like they did with Sara. However,
well, it's interesting. Yeah, you know, I interviewed these guys that started a company, a new app called Career Karma, and they have a podcast called Breaking Into Startups. And they all pivoted into startups from totally different careers. And once they got in and realized, A, how many people actually pivot, and B, how many different types of careers there are in Silicon Valley. There are, like, you know, many amazing tech careers for people who are non-coders. They wanted to spread the word. And I had them give advice in the book. And Timur Meister, one of the interesting things he told me was they always actually recommend that people reach out to people on LinkedIn that actually have similar careers to what they're looking to go into and ask for advice. And
that's a good idea.
What they did, yeah. And, you know, I don't think you want to be, like, stalking people necessarily on LinkedIn, but, you know, a nice, you know, thoughtful, polite, you know, message, you know, asking if someone has advice for you is definitely reasonable. And I think a lot of people really respond to it, and a lot of people really do want to help and mentor other people, especially people who came from other careers, because it's not easy to make a switch. And if people can illuminate that path and let you know, like, what the obstacles to avoid are and maybe what you should be doing and a class you should be taking or someone you should talk to, often people want to do that. And I've definitely found that in my career. So I do think that's a really good piece of advice that you bring up.
It is a real – thank you. I do, too. And I think that short of stalking, a genuine message, reaching out, and what I always advise people, too, and I get a lot of this from people who are writers or want to be connected to other authors or this, is, you know, at least know what the person is writing that you're asking.
Like, yes,
take some time. You would not believe some of the messages I get. Well, you would,
me
I'm
too.
Sure.
No,
and,
me
and
too.
I'm thinking, do you know what I do? Have you ever tuned into the podcast? Like, you know, it's and locally, because I host so many events, and I host them outside of Rhode Island, but many here, I'm like, have you ever come to the author series? Stop by, say hello. You know, we're third Tuesday. It's just, it's funny. So I always tell people, if you're going to reach out and ask, have a little sense of what the person does. You know, just don't be lazy. Take some time to really know what you're asking, and you may get a very different answer. And I think that is such a great way to open up your sort of mind to what's out there, but also to have it be more of an exchange with the person you're requesting something from, you know. But I think that reaching out on LinkedIn is a really good way, as opposed to stalking somebody via Facebook or message. You know, be professional.
Yeah, I think there is, to me, like, yeah, I think that that's, I like LinkedIn. It just feels like a more professional environment.
Right? Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and I do sometimes, you know, get DMs from people who definitely don't know what I write about. And I agree. I find it interesting. But I do think if you do take the time to really research the person you're reaching out to.
Yeah, a little time.
That makes a big difference, and it makes it more likely that they will respond.
You want a positive result, so right. You want to set yourself up for success. So a little bit of it doesn't even take that long. But I know people also just are anxious and they want information quickly. And this book is such a great resource. I can only imagine at your events, people must want to know, you know, more or get into what can. Or I don't know if they're asking you very specific questions of how to guide them, or, you know, does it become?
It's a combo. You know, I had my first event at Politics and Prose for Take the Leap.
Yeah,
in January 2nd. Mm-hmm. And I was a little worried. I thought, you know, it's right after the new year. You know, it's cold. you know, maybe we won't get a huge turnout, and it was actually standing room only.
Wow.
And it was such an inspiring event because people wanted, there were a lot of people there who wanted to ask questions about how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then there were a lot of people who wanted to share their stories, and they were in the midst of changes themselves or about to embark on it or thinking about it or had already done it and wanted to share that with people. And it just ended up being this very inspiring connection. People were really having meaningful connections and talking afterwards, and it was great. And I do these events. It's not just me speaking. I always interview. I pick a place where I have someone in the book.
Oh,
so
cool.
I interview them, and I have these conversations, and we talk all about how they took the leap. And it's a little bit of an insight into what's in the book, but also, you know, we get to go a little further and find out what people are asking. So I would say it's like the interactive version of my book, which
that's
I love.
Awesome. I think that's the best of the whole thing, because the conversation that comes out of it and, you know, as people are witnessing that, it's kind of like your book live. Who are you interviewing in Boston?
So Boston is the one place I don't have anyone.
Oh.
So it's just me. But in Salt Lake City, I'm interviewing Stacy Bear, who is a fascinating guy. He's an Iraqi war veteran. He's a really smart guy, but he had terrible substance abuse problems and PTSD when he got back, and he had mm-hmm. a bunch of different jobs, but was just having trouble really finding his way and was incredibly depressed. And he had a friend take him out climbing. And something about that experience was so transformative for him and so healing that after he got through the emotional, he felt for the first time he felt not guilty for living. And
wow,
and
amazing.
Yeah, that, but his first thought after that was, we need to get more veterans out climbing.
Yeah.
And so he ended up working for the Sierra Club for many, many years, and working with them on outdoors programs for veterans. And now he does programs for people who are sober.
How meaningful
sober
is
community.
That?
Yeah.
That's just such a story to really transform and that keeps you going. That keeps you motivated, giving back like that.
He's amazing because he saw the power, he saw the transformation in himself, and then he has made his whole career about helping other people transform. And so the book really hit a nerve for him because he knew it was about change. And so I can't wait for that conversation. That's going to be March 18th in Salt Lake City at King's English.
Oh, fabulous. That's going to be awesome. And this is the kind of book, too, that it's always going to be relevant. And I suppose you could always, you know, do more and keep it going, because people are going to be constantly changing and evolving. I find it fascinating. I mean, you have Barbara Corcoran in here, and certainly we're fans of the Shark Tank show. And whenever people come up with these, we love that show and the backstory. And so this is a lot of backstory and a lot of people who have changed or seen a gap in the market, or they have a personal experience where something has been meaningful and they've created a product around it. I, you know, the stories are endless.
Barbara has great advice. She is so, she had 22 jobs, I think, before she was 23.
Amazing. Yeah.
And her advice is very actionable and smart and savvy. And, I mean, I learned so much from her. I mean, I could have talked to her forever.
Yeah, I can imagine. Like, how do you, like, where do you even cut it off? It's like, that's
no, exactly.
Her attention.
Exactly. Exactly. I had what I did was I had a lot of – there are a lot of real people in the book who have made these changes. But then I also found people like Barbara Corcoran and Bobby Brown.
Yeah,
who,
I love that.
Yeah, who are amazing business success stories, and I had them share their advice. Bobby's interesting, too, because not only is she an entrepreneur, but she's actually in the middle of doing her own transformation right now at 61. She left her namesake brand, which is now, you know, owned by Estee Lauder. She left 2 years ago, and she has a new brand called Evolution 18. So she's in that process right now. One of the interesting things in the book is it's not just stories about people who, you know, had big dreams and wanted to do this forever. There are a lot of people in the book who didn't expect to make these kinds of changes. And, you know, technology is really shifting. So many careers are shifting radically, really quickly. So there are people in the book who were fired and had to figure out a next step. And there are people in the book whose industries were shrinking and they had to figure out a next move. I mean, I started out as in the art world, but then I quickly shifted to magazines, and I thought I'd have a career as a magazine writer forever. And in 2008, it became very apparent that that just wasn't possible financially. I had editors, you know, asking if they could cut my rates in half.
Yes, wow.
And the rates were already low.
I know. No thank you.
So I had to create a whole branding arm of my business. And that was something I definitely didn't expect, but it was I saw it as an opportunity, and it has allowed me then to continue with the editorial side. So again, I mean, there are so many people who might find themselves in careers that aren't going in the direction that they want to go, or there might be layoffs, or you know, corporations moving to different parts of the world, and they will also find people and stories to relate with in the book.
That is the cool part, because there were so many people in this. You know, you have such a wide range of stories and interspersed famous people that we would know and their words of wisdom. But like you say too, it's not just this major change. It's also reading the temperature of your industry, seeing what's down the line, and just always realizing that things can be, you know, unexpected things happen, and then you have to regroup, but also sort of staying ahead of the forecasting, or seeing where, you know, like you say, with magazines, seeing them going online, or the changes are just happening so, you know, it's like a speedy thing. So it's like, you know, trying to keep up, or think of it, an industry you think would just never sort of change, and then there it is, it's changed. Like, we sometimes play that game, like, well, people will always need whatever, but the delivery method may be different, or the iteration of it. So it's like, you know, what's coming down, you know, if we had a crystal ball, it would be clear. You know, you're always sort of paying attention and keeping it interesting for yourself. And the stories in this book, and I'm talking to Sara Bliss, Take the Leap, Change Your Career, Change Your Life, and you can find her on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and at
sarabliss.com.
There was also a story about a woman. She left her job and worked in a flower shop. I forget. I liked that one.
Yeah, she's amazing, and she's the one that I did the event with D.C. at Politics and Prose.
Oh, that was her.
Yeah, her name is Tess Finnegan. And she has her company's called Green Hydrangea Flowers, and she was a lawyer. She worked for the Justice Department. She was a federal trial attorney, and she said she was like a paid fighter. You know, she was running on adrenaline. She was always angry. She was always fighting, and that was her job. And she had children and just thought, you know what, I need something that is kinder and gentler and softer, and that, you know, I can kind of bring home a happier self to my children. And it made her reset. And so she ended up thinking of a few different careers. She created what she calls a board of directors for herself, three friends who were in different businesses, and she pitched these three business ideas, and they walked through some of them, and there were reasons why the other ones weren't good fits. But for the third one, the flower shop job, a friend of hers was like, well, can you just go, you know, maybe get a job? Why don't you get a job in a flower shop and see if you like it?
Smart
advice. She thought, wow, that's easy. She was already taking time off because she just had a baby. So she walked in with a baby on her hip and said, are you looking for work? I mean, looking for anyone. And he was. And she started at $16 an hour, and he made her really work from the ground up. She was sweeping floors and answering phones, but at the same time, he was teaching her the business.
Just like Mr. Miyagi in The Karate Kid.
Totally. Exactly. Yeah, she really had to go through the whole thing. But but she left there with this real knowledge about the art of arranging and also about how to run that business. And now she has the business on her own, and she actually makes more money than she did as a federal trial attorney. It's taken her a few years, but she's there, which I think is really interesting.
Isn't that cool? The thing about that story, I know she also always wanted a dog. There was a dog when she worked.
Yeah.
So I was hoping her story is going to end with a puppy coming home. Like I was reading her story, and I'm like, and then she brought home a puppy. I know she's got the children, so maybe that's on her. You know, and if she winds up with a dog, please keep me posted, because
I think she does have a dog now.
Does she?
I think she does. I think she has the business out of her garage because she wanted. She realized that she didn't want to have the overhead of a store, and she has a dog and her kids, and
Does have it. Okay, we have to add that in. So I was reading, and I'm like, she needs to, you know, if this were a novel, it would wind up with, like, you know, dog arriving at her house with a little red bow on his head. I just love this book. Again, I could go on and on, but everybody should get a copy and read it for themselves. It's called Take the Leap, Change Your Career, Change Your Life. Sara Bliss, there are so many wonderful things about this book. It is such a treasure, and I am giving this to more friends.
It is a good birthday present.
It's
really
such a great gift.
It really is. I know. Well, I always say who you are in, you know, one decade doesn't have to be who you are in the next. And I think if we start opening ourselves to that possibility that change is good and change is part of life and being, you know, open to these shifts and pivots, which some might be more extreme and some might be more subtle. But I think the people that seem to do the best in life from all of my interviews, I think what I've learned are the people that are open to change and open to possibility.
Possibilities are endless, and what an exciting world to live in. Thank you for sharing this, and I hope to get to meet you and have a great time in Boston. The confetti should all be cleared up by the time you get there.
I hope so.
And before I let you go, I know Christina Aldra was in this book. And so she's one of our favorites. We love her.
Oh, she's amazing.
We love her books, and her story is a fabulous one, also leaving corporate life. She's an amazing novelist. What's a book that you've read recently that you'd like to share with the audience, fiction or nonfiction either?
I just actually read Hourglass by Danny Shapiro.
Fabulous.
Yeah, because I want to read Inheritance, but I hadn't read Hourglass yet, so I went back and read it. And especially as a creative person who deals with the financial realities of working for yourself, she was very candid about the struggles that you go through often with jobs that you love and jobs that you feel like you can't leave, and that are like tied to you. So I just thought it was a beautiful story, and then how that affected her life as a mom, and also having a partner, her husband, who's also a creative person. And her writing's also just incredibly beautiful and poignant and moving. So it was a treat to read it.
It is. Danny's one of my favorites. So did you read Inheritance yet or no?
I haven't. It's on my list.
You are in for a treat. It is quite a book. I'm going to run. Thank you so much, Sara.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Robin.